Hi, Amanda. Welcome to the Integrative Health Coach Success Podcast.
Hello, I'm excited to be here.
Yes, so we're excited to have you. And I'm really excited for you to share your business wisdom with our listeners. Again, it's going to be a topic that we haven't touched much upon yet. And it's always exciting for me to bring our listeners new information. So thanks for being here. All right, what we'll do to start is if you could share with our listeners a little bit about what you're currently doing. So in the health and wellness space, what are you doing? What does it look like? And then we'll go from there.
Well, I'm a registered dietitian with a passion for health and wellness, and I'm currently running a signature group-based program called Lean, Living Energized and Nourished. I developed my own app that I use to facilitate my program, and been able to help thousands and thousands of clients over the last couple of years doing that.
Wow, that's amazing. Okay, so let's back it up a little bit because I heard you said registered dietitian. What were you doing before that? Were you doing more of were you in a clinical setting? How did you kind of go from A to B? It sounds like this is new in the last 3 years. What were you doing in this space before that?
Yeah, so for nearly 20 years, I worked as a clinical dietitian in a weight loss program. It was the hospital setting, you know, working kind of one-on-one with clients. And it was approaching my 40th birthday. And I remember thinking, I'm either going to be sitting here saying the exact same thing, doing the exact same work, making the exact same amount of money 20 years from now, or I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to, you know, create a new path for myself. So it was kind of right before my 40th birthday, 4 years ago, that I decided to create a side hustle. That's really where I started. I didn't leave my full-time job. I just kind of created this kind of virtual opportunity on the side. And I'll tell you, my goal was to make an extra $1,000 a month. Because I felt like what I was missing the most in terms of fulfillment in my life was travel. I just wanted to have a little extra money to maybe take two fabulous vacations a year. And so that was my initial goal, to make an extra $1,000 a month. And it ended up honestly exploding. And 12 months later, I was able to leave my full-time job. I had multiplied my hospital salary by 10, and the rest is history.
Wow. So inspiring. And it's amazing how you say, like, it was just a little bit, you kind of thought, I just need to do this, but it was also serving a passion. It wasn't coming from a place of, you know, lack mindset. You were kind of like, you know what? I need more of this. This is what my life needs more of. And usually when we kind of go into it from an abundance mindset of what we need and what will fulfill us, it kind of takes off in a different direction. For sure.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay, so it sounds like it's mostly group-based and virtual. Can you tell us a little bit about what it currently looks like, how you developed it, how it works, everything about it, if you don't mind?
Yeah, so in my clinical setting, you know, I worked a lot one-on-one with clients, and we had this one kind of new patient day. I'm so used to saying clients now, not patients, but kind of like a new patient day. And what I found myself was working, like meeting with the client one-on-one, and essentially saying the same exact thing over and over and over for 8 hours straight. And it was exhausting. And obviously, you know, taking in a new client, it was about an hour appointment. So, you know, I could only see maybe 5, 6, 7 clients a day. And my program was like, listen, we have the volume. Like, we want to see more clients. How can we do that? And I said, okay, well, what if we brought in 4 or 5 clients at a time, and I was able to deliver my general nutrition message in this group setting, which usually took about 30 to 45 minutes, and then bring each person in one-on-one and spend 15 minutes, you know, 20 minutes taking history and kind of collecting and giving them that kind of individual attention. And so we really created this model of where, you know, we delivered the bulk of the content in these kind of mini group sessions, and it allowed us to double, triple, quadruple the amount of new patients that we were able to see in a day. And so when I decided to kind of branch off and work virtually, I really wanted to replicate that model because I knew that that was the one way that I was going to scale. If I was going to make $1,000 a month while working 40 hours a week, you know, I had to have the ability to work with a bunch of clients for a short amount of time. So that's really how that kind of group model came about.
Okay. And so what you do on, you know, a weekly basis, daily basis, do you kind of do that same thing where you're spending a bulk of the time talking about the general thing? Because there's so many parts of health and wellness that every single person need to hear. And then there's, you know, the small niches that matter individually to each specific person. But generally speaking, about 80% of it applies to every single person. So do you still do that where you kind of like break off individually that, you know, with the people that are part of your program?
It's all foundational work. And, you know, as a registered dietitian, the thing that frustrates me the most about nutritional guidelines, nutrition education, is how complicated we make it. So that's really my mission in Lean, is to simplify nutrition. And honestly, and for those of you that are just kind of starting your programs and starting your, you know, working, you know, with clients, here's the thing. What I found very early on is that if you overwhelm people with the nitty gritty, you know, the minute stuff that yes, ultimately will matter in the long run, they check out, like you've already done them in. So what I focus, I would say at least 75% of my time and effort and education on a daily basis in my 7-week program is foundational work. I always tell my clients, you're not special. You know, whether you have diabetes or hypertension or PCOS or Hashimoto's, you're not special. You still need that foundational work. Without that foundational work, all of this other kind of nitty gritty stuff doesn't work. Mm-hmm. So, you know, yes, to answer your question, the bulk of my education is always going to be on foundational support, the importance of sleep and whole food nutrition and, you know, mindset and things like that. And then that last 25% is really dialing in on the individual's needs. So my program creates daily support and accountability. And I think it's really what sets my program apart from, you know, other kind of group-based programs is that, you know, my clients are interacting and checking in every single day. So I suggest, you know, if you're looking at creating a signature group-based program, I would suggest that you consider, you know, creating a very high-touch program. That's what I call it. In my clinical setting, I would see my clients every 2 weeks. A lot can happen every 2 weeks. I mean, that even feels like very frequent follow-up, but so much happens in 2 weeks. You know, someone can be really good for 3 days and then completely fall off the wagon, you know, and there's, you know, 10, 11 days where they struggle. So if you can create your services where you have the ability to have that kind of high touch mindset, people are so much more successful in the long run, because this is what I have found. Okay. I've been in the field of weight loss nutrition for well over 20 years. People know what to do. They just struggle to do it. So what they're looking for from you is not necessarily knowledge, it's support, you know? So yes, you are going to provide upper level knowledge through what you've learned through IHP. I'm level one certified. But at the end of the day, it's really going to be you checking in on them, you holding them accountable, you supporting them when they fall off track or when they're doing well.
Yes. I couldn't agree more. It's such a basic human need to feel supported and even feel like you belong. And I think that's what a group setting, especially for women, can give. It's this kind of place where you feel supported by lots of women. You're obviously an amazing lead support, but they probably feel supported by other women in the program. And a lot of the people who have been listening to this show for a while know that I have a 15 year ago background in personal training. And the one thing that I miss about personal training was how frequently I got to see my clients. I used to say, when I saw a client one time a week, I used to say a lot can happen in 6 days. Like, and that's not even 2 weeks. My clients who I saw twice or three times a week, always had a way better success rate than the clients I saw once a week, because there was less time for them to fall off track, less time for them to feel accountable or supported. So I couldn't agree more. And yeah, it's the one thing that I miss about that high touch type of business, where you're able to constantly be in contact and, you know, like the dishwasher broken, that they got stressed, and the kids, you know, you're able to kind of form personal relationships too.
Yeah, absolutely. And it is those kind of day-to-day stressors that throw people off. You know, I actually had the privilege of standing on the TEDx stage in March presenting my message about the number one reason why dieters fail. And it is the all or nothing mindset. And I always say that it is that pivotal moment in your path that completely puts you into a 180 with regards to your health and wellness. So, you know, a lot of people will, especially in January, they're going to make a commitment to, you know, getting healthy and doing a diet or whatever. And, you know, whatever they choose to do, I say all diets work. It's just how sustainable or how consistent you're able to be with the diet that matters in the long run. And typically for most people, it's just like something happens. Somebody gets sick, somebody gets divorced, somebody's dishwasher breaks, you know, something happens that reduces their ability to put a lot of attention on their health and wellness. And for so many, when they can't do it all, they just choose to do nothing. And so we as coaches have to constantly be encouraging our clients that, you know, progress, not perfection, you know, 80-20, you don't have to do it all to be successful, but you got to be pretty darn consistent to be moving forward. So that's a nice thing about creating a signature group-based program, is because, again, you can work with a lot of people. You can create a daily check-in option, you know, where you're prompting them, what's your biggest win? What's your biggest struggle? You know, how was your meal prep today? Whatever it may be. And then you're able to, you know, support and encourage them in a positive way, whether they're on track or off track. So there's a lot of different ways that you can really set up that accountability piece.
Yes, yes, of course, which ultimately is what put somebody more off track or gets them back on track. And it's intervening in that moment before somebody's so far gone off the track that it takes way more time to pull them back on. Yeah. It's so important.
Yeah. And there's things, and again, in terms of when you're setting up your practice, you know, so my platform is called Spring. It's Spring without the I. So check it out, Spring App on Instagram. And we have a lot of things built into the platform that helps health and wellness entrepreneurs support group-based programs. For example, I can run a quick report and see who hasn't posted in the last 2 days, who hasn't commented, who hasn't liked. And then I can send out a quick like notification or a quick email and say, hey, I miss you. Are you good? Or are you bad? You know, and I can't tell you how many people are like, wow, I can't believe that you noticed I was gone, you know? So it's just little things like that. Even when I work one-on-one with clients, I don't work a lot one-on-one with clients because I don't have time. It's not scalable for me, but even with a small amount of one-on-one clients that I do work with, you know, they get kind of texting back and forth. And if I don't hear from them in a couple of days, you know, I'm going to be reaching out to them. And again, I think that's the difference between, you know, getting clients and keeping them, because that is the hardest part, guys. Okay. You guys know getting new clients is so much work. You have to have funnels in place that allow you to keep that client once you get them.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. I couldn't agree more. And again, back to my personal training days, it was that was my favorite part. I loved when I never got new clients because it meant I was keeping all of my old ones. And the more relationship, you know, the deeper the relationship gets. I actually had a client, you know, recently who said, oh my gosh, I miss you so much. I didn't realize, like, I went and got another personal trainer and I'm getting like the same results, but it had nothing to do with the personal training. I think some people could have been insulted. I was not the best personal trainer in the world. I was a pretty darn good coach and, you know, support system. And I think that's what so many people are missing. We live in this world where we're just like nose to the grindstone and people are working and raising kids and trying to do so many things with such little like high touch support, you know, as you put it, that when you know there's somebody out there that actually cares about your success, it gives you a reason to want to continue to goal set and to reach your goals, because someone cares other than just you.
And that's what's going to set you guys apart from everybody else. You know, here's the good news. The health and wellness space, unfortunately, people need us more than ever before. Okay. You know, with what we've been through over the last 18 months, you know, people are just in a really kind of vulnerable place. But I know as a new entrepreneur, I was very intimidated to put myself out there. You know, what are people going to think? I know you guys talk a lot about that, but that those are the little things that set you apart from other health and wellness professionals, you know, having those kind of high touch moments. Again, you're probably not teaching people something that they don't already know. So don't get bogged down on, you know, your knowledge base and how much you know. You know, I always say keep it simple, because when you kind of talk in really upper level terms, you lose people, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like bring it down to that really that foundational stuff that people struggle with the most, and then set yourself apart by creating that support and accountability that other entrepreneurs, other, you know, health and wellness professionals are unable to provide.
Yes, yes. And going back to something that you just reminded me of now, which I'd love to highlight for the listeners, you kind of said like the foundational stuff, that's the stuff that matters. I always say to clients, you're going to be a slave to these supplements that lower stress. You're going to be a slave to hormonal balancing supplements and all of this stuff if we don't fix your sleep and your stress. Because I can give you all the supplements in the world, but you can bet you'll be on them to maintain the results for a long time if you don't fix your sleep and your stress. And why take supplements for something that's quite easily addressable by adjusting lifestyle? And so doing those foundational things can save people the hassle and like that kind of, you know, constant swirling of needing to be on supplements and are they helping and are they not? It's freeing in a way to give people just the foundation.
Yeah, absolutely. And here's the most frustrating part is when you encourage someone to buy hundreds of dollars worth of supplements, and then they come back, you know, 1, 2, 3 months later and go, they didn't work. Well, they didn't work because they weren't doing the foundational work, you know? Mm-hmm. So then it kind of makes you look, it puts you in a bad position. Like, you know, the things that you're recommending are not really worth it. So it always has to start with, you know, that foundation.
Yes, absolutely. Okay, so let's switch gears a little bit, because I'm sure the listeners are like, okay, she's got group programs. It sounds like there's a lot of people in them. Where did she find all these people? How did she build interest of all of these people? And we talked a little bit before we started recording about email lists and how you've kind of grown those. So if you would kind of add a little bit of business aspect to that, how did you grow your email list? What are kind of some pointers for the listeners?
So I will say that I grew the bulk of my business with social media. However, you cannot put all your eggs in Instagram, okay? Especially with how volatile social media is right now. You have to have a secondary way to retain and connect with your clients. And the best way to do that is through an email list. Now, again, I want to give you guys motivation because I'm 43. I ain't no spring chicken over here, okay? I jumped into the social media game with 400 Instagram followers and 400 Facebook followers, and have since then grown to kind of where I am now. You can, you know, follow me on social media. And I did that simply by putting out a ton of content. And I'm sure you guys talk a lot about that. When I first started, I would take a couple of business courses and they would say, you know, give a little, but don't give it all. Make them pay for the rest. Well, I always say I sucked at that. I just give it all. And so what I honestly sell is support and accountability. All right. So here, you know what to do. All right. I just showed you every single thing to do. But if you are confused, you're struggling to do it, you need someone to hold your hand, join my Lean program. That's what you're going to get. So I think that that's a really unique approach so that you're not feeling salesy or you feel like you're hiding stuff, you know, from your followers or whatever. You're an open book. All right. So, and then in addition, as I was growing my social media following, I started growing my email list, and again, started with nothing. I have 40,000 emails now, so I've got like a nice little start. And there's a couple of ways that I would suggest growing your email list. Number one, freebies. Okay. Give away something. People love a free download. And I wish I had like a really quick access to one of my first freebies, because it literally was a Word doc with clip art that I turned into a PDF. Like, stop overthinking the production value of your content, okay? When you're starting, the worst money you will spend is, you know, hundreds and hundreds, thousands of dollars on websites and, you know, beautiful PDFs and stuff like that. You don't need it, especially now. I mean, again, what we've gone through, quarantine and everything, people are a little bit more lax about what their expectation is. So some of my free, freebies, free downloads would be, you know, 5 fall macro-friendly recipes, or, you know, how to make meal planning easy, or, you know, 4 moves to sculpt your booty, whatever your niche is, you know, 3 things to improve your thyroid health. And just, you know, create a nice little Word doc, keep it super simple. And then I use just a simple, you know, link in my bio. I don't know if you guys have talked about like link trees and all those fun things that you can, you know, kind of use to have multiple links in your bio. And then like, if you have a program like MailChimp, you know, basically you can set up, you know, kind of a funnel right through those email programs, MailChimp, ActiveCampaign, so that again, the follower comes, clicks on your link, puts in their email, their name. I now collect phone numbers because texting is going to be the next big thing. So collect whatever data you want to collect, but at least get an email address. And then they click send, you know, submit, and then the product is automatically emailed to them. So freebies. Right now, I probably have about 10 different freebies that I kind of rotate through. Alcohol, you know, I've got a holiday guide. So think about, you know, the time of year and maybe what your ideal client looks like and what they want. So that's a great way to collect an email address. Another way is to do a free webinar or a free talk. You know, all you need is a Zoom account. So again, you're just asking for people to sign up for your webinar, your talk. You can, again, run this through your email campaign. They click submit, and then you send them the Zoom link. I do a webinar once a month. So I always have a free webinar. It's just, you know, most of the time it's just a basic general nutrition webinar, talks about my passion, you know, my philosophy with regards to nutrition, you know, why people would want to work with me. And again, it's not salesy. I literally just give them my entire lean program. And at the end I say, you know, if this sounds good, or you're overwhelmed and, or you need support, like, you know, all this, but you struggle to do it, sign up to work with me type of thing. So free webinars are really good. Free workouts. You know, if you are a personal trainer, I'll do a free workout every couple of months, and, you know, again, do it through Zoom, have them sign up. That's how they get the link. So anytime that you can provide them with a service that is essentially for free is a great way to start collecting emails. And then, you know, once you start having your email base, it's, you know, start a newsletter. You know, maybe it's once a month, because I know it can feel overwhelming as, you know, an entrepreneur to feel like you got to be doing all these things. But I'll send out, you know, a couple of emails a week. And, you know, usually it's, I'll pull a recipe that I posted on Instagram. I'll pull, you know, a fun reels that I did. So I'm really just kind of repurposing, you know, a blog post or something and sending it out to my followers, letting them know when, you know, sessions are starting, return client discounts, all of that kind of stuff. But having that email list allows you to not rely on, you know, big tech to dictate your business and where your clients are.
Yes. Yes. I love that, because you're right. I mean, taking our own destiny into our hands is an important part of it, because who's to say that like social media doesn't just go up in flames tomorrow. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so I, based on kind of everything that you just said, I'm curious about like your content creation. Do you find that a majority of the successful content creation, it sounds like maybe happens on Instagram and then you repurpose it? Is that where most of like your social media business falls?
Yeah. You know, I think you have to choose the platform that you feel most comfortable on. And mine has just been Instagram. But I would encourage you to open all the platforms, all right? And absolutely repurpose your content everywhere because you're going to have a different client. You know, I feel like Facebook is a little bit of the older client, you know? So if you're looking to work with women over 50, that's probably where you need to be, but you can't ignore Instagram and you can't ignore TikTok because they're all sitting over there watching those, you know, funny videos. So for me, it's just easy. For example, Reels are really hot right now. I know when I started my business, Facebook Live was brand new and I went live 2 or 3 times a week. And that's, you know, understanding what is new and greatest. If you really want to use social media, I'll tell you also for my first 3 years, I never once paid for an ad. Never once. So it's a myth that you have to pay for ads, you know. Again, so all I did was put all my focus on taking my knowledge, my 20 years as a registered dietitian, and just putting it out there in sound bites. And at the time it was live. So I went all in on live and saw huge momentum, you know, with my growth very quickly. Now it's this, you know, these stupid reels. I know they're stupid. We all hate them. You know, people like make fun of me and I'm like, dude, I'm just growing my business. Like, you know, you can make fun of me, but this is what I have to do, unfortunately, to play the social media game. But the nice thing about it is I create a reels on Instagram. I automatically post it on TikTok. I automatically put it on YouTube Shorts. You know, I'll go ahead and put it on Facebook. So I create that one content and it goes everywhere. LinkedIn, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube. Those are the big ones. I think those are the ones that you cannot ignore. But again, when I was first starting out, I was told from all these kind of business courses is you should put something different on each platform. Well, ain't nobody got time for that, you know? So that was overwhelming that I felt like I had to create 5 different pieces of content to put out. No, I just one and you know, go for it. And I'll just share with you real quick, just my strategy for content creation, because I know that can feel overwhelming. And I know probably this is what you talk about all the time, but
give us all your, it's not okay. Actually something that we've talked a ton about. So please give us.
Good. So, I like to batch my content and I do it by first starting out with theme days. So Motivational Monday, Takeout Tuesday, Tasty Thursday, Fitness Friday. So I kind of create like a theme around what I'm going to post that day. And initially I would start out and maybe every Sunday, I would go ahead and plan my content for the week. If you're waking up every morning and you're spending an hour and a half trying to put a post out, you are wasting your time. Okay. There's much better. And again, you'll just quit because it's just a time sucker. So if you sit down for an hour or two once a week and go ahead and pre-plan your post for the week to come, it's so much easier. And I am of the mindset that quantity is a little bit better than quality. I know, and I'm sure a lot of people will fight me on that, but it doesn't have to be perfect. You just want to get it out. Okay. So you may just make a motivational quote on Monday. Again, I repurpose, I will, you know, tag a blogger and share their recipes, you know, I'll film a couple of fitness moves and make a reel or something. So creating those themes is very helpful for me to not feel overwhelmed, you know, okay, it's Tuesday. I need a takeout option. Here's my favorite option from Taco Bell, whatever. So that's a good strategy. The other strategy is, again, you know, just kind of simply bulk filming. So when it comes to reels, so I took a shower today for you guys. Okay. I put on some makeup. I got a cute dress on. Trust me, this afternoon, I'm going to film 2 or 3 reels, you know, so I'm just going to batch film those. It's probably going to be like a little lip syncing, whatever. And so then I've got like a file, you know, I probably have about 20 drafts right now that, again, I can kind of quickly pull up, think of how it applies to my niche, and then, you know, post that. So anytime you can batch your social media content, is a good idea. I will say now I batch mine a month at a time. So I sit down, I map out like 4 hours once a month where I sit down and I kind of plan. I use Buffer. It's a kind of a social media organizer. And I go ahead and kind of put my pictures in, I put my posts, my motivation, whatever it may be, testimonies. And I'll go ahead and write everything out. And then I have it set where I can actually manually post it myself, you know. So a lot of people will say, oh, don't use those programs. They reduce your engagement. But here's the thing. If I don't use that program, nothing goes out. So for me, something going out with half the engagement is better than nothing going out. So don't let, you know, people tell you things like that that overwhelm you. Find what works for you and makes your time the most efficient.
Of course. Yeah. And Dr. Cabral is a big, I don't know how much he talks about it in IHP1, but he's a big believer in kind of that batch, you know, even if it's just you taking care of your own wellness, like meal prepping and just talk. I mean, people use batching in many successful ways that aren't, you know, putting out social media content. It's a very effective way to, because I think we all, like, the mental load is the worst, right? It's not the hours necessarily. It's just the mental load of, oh my God, I have to figure out something in 45 minutes before I drop the kids off or before I do this. And shoot, I don't have enough time, forget it. And then it doesn't get done. Yeah. And so planning ahead is a super effective way to alleviate the mental load of it. And then being able to feel like you know, you're in the place where it's not stressful to actually go ahead and do it.
Exactly. I mean, just it frees up so much more time to then work on your business on the back end. Yeah. But I will say, from an entrepreneur, you know, marketing to new clients is what you spend a lot of time doing. A lot of time.
Yes. And would you say that that's the most important part of growing a new business?
I mean, obviously, you know, creating a program and a service that has value and produces results and gives you, you know, good testimonies and feedbacks and things like that is important. But I think people get bogged down with, like, program creation and what am I going to give my client and how's it going to work before they actually start feeling I don't want to say hard, but it's hard work to actually get clients, you know. It's creating that, like, no trust factor. And that's what it's about, is like setting yourself apart from everybody else in terms of why they want to work with you. Cause there's 100 of me out there, but why do they want to work with me? And, you know, people are going to see your content. I can't tell you how many people jump in my DMs and like, hey, Amanda, I followed you for the past year and I'm finally signing up for Lean, you know? So it's not like you get a new follower and then, you know, 2 days later, they jump into your program. Like, they want to see your content. Like, they want to see what you have to offer with regards to health and wellness and what you have to offer, but also, like, how do you live your life? You know, I think that I am very successful because I'm very relatable. I don't try to show this, you know, image of perfection. I really put out the mess in my life, you know, with my kids and myself and, you know, my own struggles. And I think people, they relate to that. You know, they don't want to work with someone who's perfectly polished and makes it look easy, because it's not easy.
Yes. Yeah. But that goes right back to the, like, no, and trust factor. I think we inherently probably trust people that are relatable much better, because there's something a little fishy about perfection, right? It's always like, wait a minute. when are we going to see the real side? Because at the base, we always can look on social media and think like, wow, she does look perfect. It must be perfect. But I think we all know deep down inside that nothing and no one is perfect. And so we're always like, wait a minute, what is she hiding? So yeah, the like, know, and trust. And I think as human beings, especially now more than ever, we like to know that we're not alone. We all have this quote unquote mess, and we all have our stuff that we're trying to figure out, navigate. And it's so, I think, motivational to know that there's other people out there overcoming it, doing it, walking the walk, even though it, you know, might not be easy all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that that's, again, a big barrier for entrepreneurs, is they think they have to be perfect, you know? So again, what I'm trying to tell you is that not being perfect will probably get you more clients than always seeming perfect.
Exactly. Yeah, I couldn't agree more. Okay, so could you share with our listeners, because I'm sure they're like, oh, we need to find her on Instagram and all that. Can you share with our listeners where they can find more about you on Instagram, websites, the name of your programs? Again, we'll link it all so that it's kind of easy access in the show notes, but whatever you kind of have to share.
Yes. Again, I'm most active on Instagram. It's Amanda Nybert, RD, and it's kind of like Nyght without the T. So Nyght, RD. You'll find me on TikTok. Same thing, Amanda Nybert, RD, Facebook, Amanda Nybert, RD. My website is amandanybert.com. Again, my signature program is Lean, Living, Energized, and Nourished. And my business flow is that I'm always marketing my new clients to join my foundational program. And then I roll them into my monthly membership where we build on that. So, you know, I mean, I know in IHP, we talk about some really upper level stuff. And I know a lot of people are super passionate about helping with that upper level stuff. But I would encourage you guys to consider making, again, a program that you can funnel new clients in with a foundational feel. And then with the goal of creating this kind of monthly membership where you start tackling gut health and thyroid health and, you know, kind of all these kind of upper level things. So,
yeah, absolutely. Because sometimes that stuff resolves with foundational work and the upper level stuff is then no longer needed. So
that's
yeah,
right.
Such a great way to put it. Thank you so much for being a guest on the Integrative Health Coach Success Podcast. I think we've given our listeners so much valuable information that always makes me feel good. So thank you for being here.
Loved it.
All right. We'll be in touch soon. Thanks, Amanda.